Good morning. Today we're happy to introduce to everybody that we are going to start the 8-minute student presentation where students of scientific communication class will talk about the introduction, the basic theory and the methodology of the topics that they select for this course. And I should remind the audience that are not going to present in the session to look upon the 8-minute presentation assessment that you need to fill for all of the presenters that are going to talk about their selected topic for the upcoming 2 weeks. And for those of whom is going to present today, it is suggested to prepare their slides before they begin their talk. And after they finish their talk, they need to submit the PDF or PPT version of their presentation slides into the Google Drive folder that already already written in the EduNex website and upload their PDF or PPT of today's presentation. Okay, without further ado, I would like to ask Nita to start our 8-minute presentation session.
Yes, sir.
Okay, for those of you who are not going to present today, you are required to fill in the assessment sheet that already provided in the EduNex and evaluate each presenter's presentation. Okay, the time is yours, Nita.
Yes, sir. Okay. Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh.
Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi
wabarakatuh. Good morning, everyone. My name is Nita Juang, and today I will present an overview of my research entitled Analysis of Groundwater Potential Using 2D Geoelectric Method with Dipole-Dipole Configuration at Siak Regency, Riau Province. Water is a natural resource that has an important function. A living creature needs pure water. Can be seen in figure 1, humans definitely need water, but the same thing with animals and plants. The increasing population in Indonesia causes the need for the clean water to increase. Meanwhile, the water supply has decreased significantly both in quality and quantity. Thus, the groundwater exploration survey is proposed to overcome the scarcity issues of the clean water. In this study, I use the geoelectric method because first, water table is conductive and allows an electric current to the flow to the ground, so that it can be used to identify the presence of subsurface water. And then geoelectric resistivity is one of variable, which is the physical properties of the rocks layer below the surface. Rock resistivity data can be used to develop a model of subsurface and stratigraphic structures in terms of electrical properties. And the last, one commonly used method is electrical resistivity method because it is efficient and economical to determine groundwater. The working principle of bioelectric is to inject electrical current into the earth. The electrode consists of two current electrodes, C1 and C2, that deliver the electrode deliver the electric current into the earth. And two potential electrodes reading is P1 and P2, reading the potential difference value after the current through the rocks. The four electrodes are plunged into the ground at a certain distance. The longer the distance of the current electrodes will cause the flow of electric current can penetrate the deeper rocks layer. With the flow electric current, it will cause electrical voltage in the ground. Electrical voltage occurring at the ground surface is measured using a multimeter connected with two voltage electrodes P1 and P2, which is shorter than the distance of C1 and C2 electrodes. When the position of the electrode when the position of the electrode was distance is current is changed to be greater than the electric voltage. Potential electrode also change according the information of the type of rocks the precipitates in the injections of electric current greater depth. From the value of current and potential difference, the apparent resistivity value can be calculated using equation 1, with the value of K can be calculated in equation 2, where K is geometry factor, I is current, delta V is potential difference, rho A is apparent resistivity. Electrode configuration is the rule for placing current and potential electrodes so as to obtain a certain pattern according to the objective to be achieved. Each electrode configuration has a different geometric factor. Geometry factor is a multiplier factor in the electrode configuration in order to obtain a stable resistivity value. Usually, the electrode configuration that are often used are planar alpha, planar beta, planar gamma, pole-pole, dipole-dipole, pole-dipole, planar sum-bersy, and equatorial dipole-dipole. In this study, I use a dipole-dipole configuration or electrode placement. In the dipole-dipole configuration, the distance between each pair of electrodes is written by A. Then the distance A and C is same with distance D and B is L. And the distance A and D is L plus A, and distance C and D is L minus A. By entering this value to the equation, the resistivity measurement can be calculated by using equation 3 and 4. This overall research can be seen from this flow chart. The research was begun with a literature review so that the author can know how the theoretical basis of this research. Then this research survey was using a sizable multi-channel system, 48 channel, with a dipole-dipole configuration with a length of 950 meters, and the electrode spacing is 10 meters. Then record the data using the software that has been installed on laptop. Next overlap the data to adjust total track length. If it match the length of the path, the data process with using the rest2 div. If no, it will resume overlapping data. After processing the data, with REST2DIV software and the inversion values then inversion results are obtained, then
sorry to interrupt, but you have 1 minute to conclude your presentation.
Sorry, sir.
You have 1 more minute to conclude your presentation.
Yes, sir. Okay. And the last step is interpretation the results of the inversion and determine the position of the groundwater level and finish. I think that's all from me. Thank you for your attention. Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh.
Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. Okay, thank you, Nita. So now we are moving on to the next speaker, which is Desdira.
Okay, sir. Can you see my screen?
Yes. Okay, you may start whenever you're ready.
Okay, hello. Good morning, Mr. Hari and everyone. My name is Distira, and I'm part of Physics of Earth and Complex System Research Division from Physics Department, Faculty of Mathematics and Natural Sciences, ITB. So this morning, I'm going to talk about sentiment analysis of public opinion related to mental health on Twitter during the COVID-19 pandemic using knife-maze classifier method. So let's start with why I'm choosing this topic. So the COVID-19 pandemic is a global crisis that not only threatens public health physically, but also mentally. It has caused fear, anxiety, and uncertainty for a lot of people. And undeniably, a lot of people are struggling to cope during this time. So what do you think people would do in this kind of situation? So some people are trying to overcome the psychological impact of the COVID-19 pandemic by simply sharing feelings with each other through social media, for example, on Twitter. Twitter has become a social network that is now used by millions of people as a medium to access and share information in real time. From tweets, we can find out about how people feel about COVID-19. So if we want to collect data of people's mental health during pandemic, we can read their tweets, right? But with million tweets on Twitter, it's gonna take a lot of work. So to process big data, we need the help of computer. But how do computer understand emotions? So this is where we need sentiment analysis. So in this study, sentiment analysis was carried out to see what Twitter user opinions about mental health using knife-based method, and also to determine the accuracy value obtained from the results of data classification using the knife-based classifier method. So just in case if anybody is wondering what sentiment analysis is in the first place, let's start by answering that question. So what is sentiment analysis? Humans express their feelings on a regular basis, and these feelings are called emotions. Scientists are using different techniques, including machine learning, to train machines on how to understand human emotions. And this is called sentiment analysis. Sentiment analysis is the field that tries to give our machines and a computer software the ability to understand the emotions of the users. In a computer's perspective, neutral and negative, with the corresponding scores of +1, 0, and -1, respectively. So the keywords of its sentence will be categorized into one of the three categories. Then the summation of the final scores will determine if the sentence is overall positive, neutral, or negative. So let us look at these three sentences as an example. So the first sentence is, since pandemic started, I feel happier because I have more time with my family. The sentence has the keyword happier, which comes from the word happy. So we conclude that this sentence is should be in a positive category. And the next sentence is, I don't think pandemic is affecting me that much. You can see that it doesn't contain any keywords that are included in the positive or negative. So we can classify this sentence as a neutral one. As for the third sentence, I feel stressed because I cannot go out. So which indicates that this sentence is a negative one since it contains the word stress. So this classification can also be done by the computer. So let's move on and see how does it actually work in a computer. First, we need to go through the pre-processing data. Pre-processing data can be referred to manipulation or dropping of data before it is used in order to enhance performance. So let's take the statement as an example. I feel stressed. The very first step of pre-processing data would be case folding, which converting all the characters in a document into the same case, either all uppercase or lowercase. The second step is tokenizing. The tokenization is nothing but dividing your statement into different set of words. And the next step is to cleaning the data. By cleaning the data, I mean to remove all these special characters, such as this exclamation mark over here. So the last step of pre-processing data would be removing the stop words. We don't need any words which do not add any value to the analytic results. So the stop words like I should be removed. And now we're left with just two words. And our task will be to classify them as whether it is a positive or negative or a neutral word. And now this is where machine learning takes the part. In this research, we are using naive-Bayes classifier method. Naive-Bayes classifier is the algorithm that should be considered for solving the classification problem. And the naive-Bayes algorithm is a machine learning algorithm which learns the probability of an object with certain features belonging to a particular group in class. The basis of the naive-Bayes algorithm is the Bayes theorem. It gives us a method to calculate the conditional probability, that is probability of an event based on previous knowledge available on the events, as you can see on the screen. Let us understand the statement first. The component of the above statement are A is a specific class, B is a data of an unknown class, P of A given B is a conditional probability of occurrence of event A when event B is true. P of B given A is a conditional probability of B given A. And P of A and P of B are the probabilities of the occurrence of event A and B respectively, where A is also called as the preposition. P of A is called the prior probability of preposition, and B is the evidence. P of A given B is called the posterior. P of B given A is the likelihood. So this sums up the Bayes theorem as posterior is equal to the likelihood multiplied by proposition prior probability divided by evidence prior probability. And so the overall flow chart would be like this. We've talked about the crawling data and the processing data, pre-processing data in the previous section, and then input the data training and the testing data into the program. And then we classify using the naive-Bayes algorithm. Once we are done with the classification, we get the results. And the last part is to analyze. Okay, so this brings me to the end of my presentation. Thank you all for listening to my presentation. I would like to hear your comment later on. Good morning.
Okay, thank you, Isdira. Okay, for the feedbacks for each presenter, I think I will talk about it probably after we're done with the whole presentation so that everybody will have the freedom to talk about their topic first, and then if their feedbacks required related to the talk itself, then I will provide to all of you during the lecture on the poster presentation preparation. Okay, let us move on to the next presenter, Jihan Chania.
Yes, sir, let me share my screen first. Okay, could you see my screen, sir?
Yes.
Okay, assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh.
Waalaikumsalam.
Hello everyone. My name is Jihan Chania. I'm a member of the research group on Earth Physics and Complex System. This time, the topic that I will bring is very relevant to our current condition, namely analyze human behavior changes in shopping due to the COVID-19 pandemic. Okay, as we know, COVID-19 was the first report in December 2019 originating from China. This pandemic has had a significant impact on world health. In addition, the COVID-19 pandemic is also having a severe impact on society and economic around the world. This unprecedented situation has serious consequences for consumer daily life and dramatically changed the way business act and customer behavior. Okay, in almost all countries in the world, the lockdown policy has resulted in change in consumer behavior, such as hoarding and impulsive behavior that deviates significantly from usually shopping behavior. The study examined that the accident and dynamic of impulse buying pattern in the rise of COVID-19 and assess the impact of the impulse purchasing behavior during the situation based on fear. This study aimed to examine the impact of COVID-19 pandemic on consumer behavior and change in their shopping habits. The study using the questionnaire survey, this questionnaire covered two main parts, their fear of health and fear of economic condition. The data acquired will be processed using the multiple linear regression to see the relationship between variable. Then the agent-based modeling to simulation of change in consumer behavior. Okay, for this part, I determined change in shopping behavior from the result as the dependent variable, and the fear of health and fear of economy condition as independent variable that affect the dependent variable. In addition, there are three hypotheses. There are three couple hypotheses. First, the initial hypothesis, or also we know as presumptive hypothesis, and the three alternative hypotheses. Okay, for the multiple linear regression analysis is used to estimate the relationship between the independent variable and the dependent variable. The equation as we show on the screen, where y is dependent variable, beta zero is constant, x is independent variable, beta n is the coefficient of the independent variable, and e is the error value. Okay, for the flowchart in at multiple linear regression. First, after the data is obtained, identify the independent and dependent variable. Next, build a multiple linear regression model based on the general equation described on the previous slide. Next, estimate the model that we use. Next, in the analysis, the result, check the adjusted R square value to measure how much variability of the dependent variable is taken into account. For is analyze the result of the result adjust R square. Next, then check the significance of the F value to see whether the model used is appropriate or not. If the value is less than 0.05, proceed the next step, the next steps. But if not, return to the estimate model. Next, after the model is accepted, the next step is analyze to the p-value. If the p-value is smaller than 0.05, the alternative hypothesis is accepted. But if the p-value is greater than 0.05, the presumptive hypothesis is accepted. Okay, the number of 0.05 used is as a threshold that can be different and is not absolute. Okay, next step is we use agent-based modeling. Agent-based modeling is used to computationally model between agent with their environment. Each agent can individually assess the situation and make decision based on a predefined set of rules. This rule will be based on the equation obtained from the multiple linear regression method. Okay. NetLogo. NetLogo is a multi-agent programming language and modeling environment for simulating natural and social phenomena. It is suited for modeling complex systems that evolve. A model can be provide instruction to hundreds or thousands of independent agents operating simultaneous. Using this NetLogo, I can simulate change in consumer behavior using agent-based modeling that I described before. Okay, so that was what I want to share with you. Thank you.
Okay, thank you, Jihan. After Jihan, we are going to see the presentation of Nazlia. Do we have Nazlia? Okay, we have Nazlia in the classroom. So please prepare the slide so that we could begin our presentation session.
Hello, sir. Can you see my screen?
Yes.
Okay. Okay. Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh.
Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi.
Good morning, sir, and all my friends here. We all have a good day. My name is Nazlia Zahra, and today I will tell you about my research topic about optimization of dose and image quality in adult and pediatric CT scan. I'm sorry. Okay. So in the beginning, when we talk about radiation according to NCRP or National Council or on radiation protection and measurement number 160. The largest increase in population radiation dose was found in patient exposure to medical procedure, and radiation dose increased with higher CT image quality due to the use of higher voltage and or electric current. As we can see in the picture below, when we increase the QVP or MIS, the CTDI will also increase. CTDI or CT dose index is a unit to express the amount of radiation dose in medical visits. An explicit consideration of relationship of CT image quality to applied dose is crucial in CT radiation protection, and ensuring high CT image quality with reduce those radiation exposure is invariably an issue, especially for radiologists and also medical physics researchers. And when we talk about medical radiation in medical physics, we have ALARA principle, where ALARA is the principle that we have to minimize the radiation dose, but also maintain the image quality of a CT scan, the metrics for image quality assessment on CT scan are examined in ICRU report number 87. There are noise magnitude, CT number, CT uniformity, and which were assessed on large sample of ROI or region of interest and low contrast resolution, CNR and SNR. And the optimal protocols for scanning adults and children or pediatric are not really determined by CNR or SNR alone, but also the image-oriented parameters such as EVP, MIR, and MIS and IR, as well as issue under investigation. And how this factor may interact remains unclear and needs to be further explored, which is the purpose of this current study. So what is the purpose of this study? This study aims to determine the optimal CT scanning protocol based on all possible metrics while conducting all overall evaluation of the effects of CT scan parameters on CT image quality and radiation dose. So move on to the next section about materials that I use in this research. There are three materials that I use in this research. The first one is CT scan, of course, the 128-row multiple size CT scanner. The second one is ACR Phantom, and the last one is Sears 5-year-old pediatric health Phantom. And parameters that are applied to the CT scans are to voltage or KVP from 80, 100, and 120 to current time, from 550 until 400 MIS. And we will operate the CT scan in axial head 2D mode. And the size thickness that we choose is 2 millimeters. And for each parameter, we will test with and without the iterative reconstruction or IR algorithm. The second material that I use, which is ICR Phantom, is equipped with 4 modules. But in this study, we will only use the module 1, 2, and 4, as shown in this figure. The module 1 was used to assess CT number accuracy, as we can show the in figure A, and the cylinder house 5 different material, which is polyethylene, bone, acrylic, air, and the background is water equivalent. And then module 2 was used to assess low contrast resolution. 25 millimeter cylinder is used to verify the cylinder to background contrast level, as you can show, we can see in figure B. And then the last one, module 4, was used to assess the high contrast or spatial resolution. And in this study, there are 3 analyses that we will do. The first one is CT examination on phantoms and CT image quality analysis. There are 2 phantoms that were used in testing CT on image quality, and the image quality was evaluated using 5 parameters. The first one is the accuracy of CT number or HU compared to the standard value of the standard phantom. The second one is contrast to noise ratio or CNR. Third is signal to noise ratio or SNR. The fourth is low contrast material CNR. And the last one is line pair resolution, where CNR and SNR can find CNR and SNR on this equation below. The second analysis is radiation dose assessment. The radiation dose were assessed by a CTDI volume, which allow for evaluation of the radiation dose at the ROI. And the last one is overall evaluation on image and radiation dose. And on this analysis, to assess overall effect and a possible trade-off between image quality and radiation dose, we use form or figure of merit that we can define as CNR square per CTDF volume. So the overall part of the study, the first one, we will set the CT scan parameters, and then we will analyze.
Apa namanya?
Three analyses. The first one is CT examination on phantoms and CT image quality analysis. Second one is radiation dose, and the last one is overall evaluation based on image quality and radiation dose. And from the three analysis that we have done, we will do analysis. So that's all that I can share with you. Thank you for your kind attention. Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh.
Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. Okay, thank you, Nesli. Let me write the time used by Nazri. Okay, and then the last speaker of today's session is Salma Arida.
Okay, sir. Before, I'm sorry because I share screen from my phone. Maybe it's not as big as my friend before.
Okay, it's okay. As long as your presentation proceed smoothly, then it is okay to use the smartphone.
Okay. Okay, can you see my slide?
Yes, we can see it.
Okay. Good morning, everyone. I am Salma Arida Mufliha, and now I will explain about green synthesis of zinc oxide by paper bottle extract as my 8-minute presentation. Okay, first, about background. The reason why I chose this topic is because of these three factors. The first one is about the direction of research. Before, people tend to do research and develop the technology to create or make big things. We know, for example, the pyramid in Egypt and the Great Wall of China, as example. But currently, the direction of research is changing. People now tend to think that smaller is finer. So we now know that there is a nanotechnology and nanoscience, and many researchers do research in this field. Okay, second one is, have you ever heard about cosmetical physics? I just heard this question last year, so I tried to look for what is cosmetical physics. So maybe cosmetical physics is not a formal term. It's commonly called and commonly known as a cosmetic science, but the main focus is physics can be used in cosmetic research. Okay, so I'm interested in this field and I want to explore more about this field. Okay, and then the third one is to use what is around us. The most simple observation is by our eyes, and we can use it in our environment. Like I personally look to my garden and see that I have paper bottle in my garden, and I try to explore what is the properties of paper bottle, and I think the paper bottle is suitable to be used in cosmetic physics because its properties such as antibacterial and anti-inflammatory and also anti-acne properties. And my aim of research is, first one, of course, I want to synthesize zinc oxide nanoparticle. And the second one, I want to study the paper bottle's role in this research. Is it act as a reductor agent or it's act as a, what is this? As a buffer, or even it act as both of them. And the third, I want to applicate the zinc oxide nanoparticle in beauty product or in cosmetics, such as sunscreen, or maybe lotion, or maybe moisturizer. And it is the current research in last 2 years. There are a lot of research in zinc oxide nanoparticle. It uses many different natural based, such as Osmium basilicum, Morinda tinctoria, and Glycosmis mauritiana. And the research also try to study about its properties such as antioxidant, antibacterial, anti-diabetic, photocatalytic activities, biofilm, anti-inflammatory, and wound healing activities of zinc oxide. And it is just a little research. You can find more about zinc oxide nanoparticle research in Science Direct, as example. Okay, next to my method. Basically, I use green synthesis method in my research. So it's used safe. It's used ecological solvent. Here I use water or aqua DM, and it is also low cost, low energy, and use non-toxic materials. Okay, my method is contain 2 steps. First one is extraction, and the second one is synthesis. The first one is extraction. First, I wash the paper betel leaf until it's clean, and then I rinse it by aqua DM. And after that, I dry the surface of the leaf with tissue, and then I dehydrate it in oven until it's dry. And after that, I crush it to make it powder by using blender. And then I filter it to remove the powdered paper bottle from the bigger size. Okay, and then after that, I heat the water in certain temperature. Basically, I use 60 degrees of Celsius, and then in another beaker glass, I mix aqua DM and paper bottle powder in certain concentration. After that, I water bath the solution of paper bottle powder in aqua DM for an hour. And after that, I cool it until it reach room temperature. After that, I filter it twice to separate the solution from the paper bottle powder. After that, we continue to the synthesis method. First, we use the precursor zinc nitrate tetrahydrate and dissolve it in our extract that we have made before in certain concentration. After that, we stir it using magnetic stirrer for an hour and certain RPM. I usually use 300 RPM, and then after 1 hour, I water bath it, and then I variate it. The variation can be from its pH, its time heating, its concentration of precursor, its concentration of zinc nitrate tetrahydrate, etc. Okay, I think that's all about me. If you have interest in this topic or maybe in cosmetic science, you can call me to discuss about it by email, by line, or by WhatsApp. Okay, that's all about me. Thank you.
Okay, thank you, Salma. And with that, we are reaching our final speaker of today's session. I would like to thank all of the presenter of today's session. In Thursday, we're going to have 11 people talking about their selected topic. And I hope that everybody learned from today's session, where everybody able to cap their presentation timing below the required time. Okay, thank you all for listening and also for talking about the scientific topic that they're selected. We're going to meet again on Thursday for our 8-minute presentation session for the second time of this week. And I'm going to remind again to the class that while you are not presenting, you still have the obligation to evaluate your friend's presentation. And after we're done with all of the presentation, all of the assessment sheet needs to be uploaded into the following Google Drive folder. And then the evaluation of this presentation and also for the 15-minute presentation will be done by the audience. Okay, by the audience. And I hope that Nita, Destira, Jihan, Nazlia, and Salma, after they're done with the 8-minute presentation, they will also send their PPT or PDF version of their slides into the following Google Drive. Okay, so the folder for the presenter's slides and the assessment will be different. Okay, thank you all. We will see you again on Thursday for our second session for this week's 8-minute student presentation. I will stop my screen sharing here, and then I will stop the recording.